it. Ho-ho! Yes, again, for the fourth time tonight, their number one goal-getter, Gabe Claussen. Pass up ahead from Brandlin, and a shot and a score! Cody Glass starts the scoring, and the Predators lead at home. Can be the hero against Dalen Kiefer, the left-handed shooter coming in, ran out of room. Januzzi stops them. Hawks win their second best start in franchise history.
If you plan on going to see the Portland Winterhawks on Friday night against Everett or Saturday against Kamloops, you should swing by and see my buddies at Cartside. It's a cart pod. It's on Williams Avenue, just a half a block north of Broadway, walking distance from the rink. They have six or so food carts that are different varieties, but you know the key is the tap house there with all kinds of different beers on tap. And if you mention this show that you listen to Pucklandia, they'll set you up with a happy hour price, which is a sweet deal. But and it should be big games against Everett and Kamloops. And keep in mind, Saturday night against Kamloops, that the Trailblazers are playing, so it's going to be busy. So just be aware of that. But yeah, go down to see my buddies at Cartside. Have a good time. Welcome into a joint edition of WHL Unfiltered, as well as Pucklandia. Pleased to be joined by Casey Bryant, the Director of Broadcasting for the Everett Silvertips of the Western Hockey League. And how's things been treating you so far up there in Everett?
Hey, first off, thanks for having me on, Chad. I really appreciate it. And it's been so far so good. We're officially back across the U.S. border after a long time spent in Canada for our East Division swing. We had our one home game before we hop right back out onto the road this weekend at the time of recording this. So, but so far so good here in Silvertip Country.
So yeah, that's we could probably get into that road trip, but I guess maybe dig down into your journey a little bit. I mean, so this is year two in that chair.
Yeah, year two in the Western Hockey League for me.
So that's has it been all that we hyped it up to be? Is it kind of been the league you anticipated? What's it been like, you know, getting your feet wet in this league?
You know, it's funny. When I first got out here and was first calling my a game between the Silvertips and Seattle Thunderbirds, it was October 15th of last year, and I remember being struck by just how fast the players moved and how crisp the passing was. You know, you barely have time to say a player's name before the puck leaves their stick and it's on to the next guy. You know, you have to really be as prepared as you possibly can as far as knowing people's names, numbers, and any factoids and get them out as quickly as you can because you have no time to breathe or think. The action is so quick in this league. And it only gets better with each passing game. I tell you what, over the course of these... You know, the calendar year and plus now that it's been out in Everett, you see some really incredible things performed on an individual basis for a lot of these guys, a lot of flashes of individual skills, some highlight reel plays, and you just get to see some really great team hockey, too. There's no one team, I think, that's led by a singular guy. Even when we were out in the East Division and watching the Regina Pats, and the Regina Pats are Connor Bedard, right? Like, it's that he is... the face of that franchise, the face of that league, face of junior hockey right now, right? And the Pats are a really stiff team to play against. They're really dynamic as far as what they're able to create. They have some really stingy defensemen. They have a good goalie back there. So you just get to see a good, crisp game that you're not just there to see Connor Bedard. You're also seeing some other really talented guys up and down that lineup too. So it's been a lot of fun being able to explore different arenas, different cities, see different players, and now I'm a bit more knowledgeable when it comes time to sit down and watch the NHL draft with my family. So they'll see a guy drafted out of the CHL and go looking right at me to see if I know the guy. So it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, I like it. And, you know, we mentioned that road trip a couple times now. So you know, your first time in some of these old, you know, classic buildings. I mean, what are some of the highlights to you know, to those new experiences?
Classic is certainly the right word to use, because they're old barns. They've got a lot of old time memories strewn across the walls. You know, banners hung of different players, different teams. A lot of pictures of old teams going all the way back to like the 80s, 70s, some of them 60s. You know, the Regina Pats have over 100 years of history strewn across their arena at the Brandt Center. And as such, of these being old arenas, you know, you can kind of tell that they were constructed not necessarily with, like, convenience in mind. You know, they kind of built it to be an ice rink, and then everything else comes secondary. So to get to a lot of the media floors, there's a lot of stairs and a lot of maze work that you have to traverse. To load into some of these arenas, there's a long walk to get to where you need to be. You know, you're loading equipment downstairs or down ramps on the other side of the building. It really is very funny to see the way that different arenas are laid out, what part of the cities they're in. The exploration, if it's a new thing, it catches my attention right away. So it was really, really cool to be able to see all these different pockets of junior hockey, get to see the fan base, you know, see the energy level in different arenas. It was a lot of fun to be able to explore that with a good group of people.
Climb the ladder in Swift Current, get in there.
Not yet. That's being saved for next year. But I tell you what, the narrow staircase in Prince Albert on the metal sheeting is tricky to traverse. I bumped my head on that, nearly concussed myself. The Regina Pats in the Brandt Center, you know, it took me about 5 minutes to fully climb from the locker room to the top to the press box. Brandon has stairs. Saskatoon has, you're up in the gondola. There's quite a few labyrinths being laid around the East Division that you have to traverse. But I have heard that Swift Current's ladder and the climb from Red Deer are the two worst. I don't see how they could possibly be longer than what I've already seen, but I'm looking forward to that next year.
Well, people love the catwalk at the Saddle Dome too. That's always just something that people like to, you know, document their trip across that thing.
Mm-hmm. So I've heard. So it just gives me something to look forward to in a year from now.
So, you know, here in Portland, you know, Mike Johnson's famous for wanting to do that trip early in the year, you know, kind of what the Silvertips did. You know, I mean, partially, you know, you're trying to get ahead of the snow, but, you know, a lot of it is, you know, kind of team bonding, and you try to, you know, go out with these guys, you know, and go to war for a couple of weeks on the road. I mean, is that, you know, did you you think that was kind of a valuable part of this trip for the Silvertips?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a great point. You know, I think it helps build camaraderie right out of the gate. You're trapped together in confined quarters for a long time. You're going through the gauntlet. And I think for a team that is as rookie-laden as we are in Everett, I think it's important for players to see the grind, to see what it takes to win games on a consistent basis, because the schedule doesn't get any more favorable when it comes playoff time. In April, when you're playing these seven-game series, you're going to play seven games over the course of 9 days, 10 days. You know, there's not going to be a lot of time to have off. So you're going to be doing a lot of traveling. You're going to be all in confined quarters. So from a player perspective, you know, by the end of the trip, you could really tell they were gassed. They were banged up, but they were playing really well. They were playing really competitively, and they went 4-2 on the trip. And the two games that they lost, they still were hanging in real tough against two really strong teams in Moose Jaw and Winnipeg. So from that standpoint, it's absolutely a valuable thing for them to go through. And I think it's a great learning experience for them as the season progresses.
You mentioned going 4-2 on this trip. I mean, you know, as the time of this recording, the Silvertips are sitting at 12-6, and for the most part, you'd be thrilled with that, you know, and think that you know, you win in games and getting results. But it's kind of a tough division at the moment, and you know, people aren't really talking about the Silvertips or giving them much credit. I mean, what's kind of your, you know, 30,000 feet feel about where they're at and how the way the standings are looking at the moment?
It is funny that you say that, because the Western Conference in general is so, so powerful this year, right? I think that every team got better. You know, the only team that maybe has taken a step back, ironically, is the team that's going to be hosting the Memorial Cup in the Kamloops Blazers, where they're kind of sitting in a similar spot where they're probably towards the middle of the pack in the standings, and they're probably going to be looking to push, right? I mean, that's the common thought, is that with the Memorial Cup coming up this year, they're going to want to build and add, and but Seattle has been much more aggressive on the trade market. So it's kind of interesting to see the balance of power. But in the U.S. division, Spokane, I think, was better. They made a few moves, so I'm curious to see how that impacts their room. Tri-City is markedly better this year. Portland is still a powerhouse. Seattle, obviously, is building to win it all this year. So for Everett, I think that you look at a lot of these games, and I think they probably feel that they should win, should have won more than they have. I think you look at our record, 12-6. I think if you were to talk to the coaching staff, talk to the players, they would say they probably should be more, you know, 14-4. You know, I think there probably should be a few games in there where either it slipped through their fingers, or you, one play bounces the other way and it's a completely different hockey game. You get a few timely stops late in the game. I think they probably feel that they have deserved a better fate than what they have. And 12-6 is nothing to sneeze at. That's a good record. But I still think that this team has not yet tapped its true full potential. They've shown flashes of it. It's just a matter of getting everyone healthy now and hitting the middle of the road here and with everyone back on the roster sheet and making that final push. This team is capable of a really good run.
Well, we talked earlier about, you know, having kind of a lot of rookies on that team, and it does kind of, you know, just looking at the score sheets, I mean, it's there are some names that aren't as familiar. Who are some of these guys that you're pretty high on so far?
You know, as far as guys that are returning, you know, Austin Roost is someone that has really turned a lot of heads. I think that Roost was listed on the central scouting list last year by the NHL ahead of the draft. He didn't get picked, and I think that really drove him. You know, I think he wants to prove, you know, that he's worthy of not just a seventh round pick as many mused he might be last year, but he wants to go in, you know, the sixth round, fifth round, fourth round. And he lived at the gym in the off season. He's a markedly better skater. I think he just looks a lot sturdier. He's skating and possessing the puck with a lot more confidence now, where he's being relied on as the driver of offense, not just kind of a bit guy who wins a battle in the corner and you know, lets other guys on his line go to work. I think he's taken huge strides forward to where when his name gets called this summer as an NHL draftee, it will be in a pretty valuable position for him. As far as rookies go, guys that are completely new to the roster, I think Jesse Heslop is certainly a name to keep an eye on. Jesse Heslop was a third-round pick in last December's WHL draft. He scored in his debut that year, and now that he's gotten a full year under his belt, you know, now that he's finally coming in as like an established member of the team, he's earned every minute that he's gotten. I think he's the team leader among forwards in plus-minus. He's one of the best 06s in the league as far as even-strength scoring. He's really flown under the radar, I think, as far as how good of a playmaking winger he's grown into. And he's still so young, and he still has a lot to show in terms of what he can do with the goal scoring. He's got great hands, great mobility. So I think that he's probably someone that's going to grow into a future leader in the league in 2-3 years. He has that potential. He'll be really exciting to watch grow.
Yeah, it's just kind of, you know, interesting getting ready for this episode here and thinking about how we're knocking on the door of American Thanksgiving and I haven't seen the Silvertips yet, which is just kind of weird as far as, you know, especially the last couple of years. I mean, you know, with being such a division heavy schedule, but you know, what you know, what to would you say to Portland fans about, you know, what to expect out of the Silvertips come Friday night?
You know, it's funny. It's funny to ask that question right now because I think if you look at our roster, it is so different compared to what you would have seen a week ago, 2 weeks ago, or a month from now. There are so many injuries where guys have been missing the last couple of games. Berezowski has missed the last couple of games. Dominic Raymond has missed the last couple of games. Oren Strom, Ty Gibson, Dexter Whittle, I mean, Aiden Sutter. So many of the key factors of the team have been missing the last couple of games. So it's kind of difficult to tell. I think as far as the immediate on Friday, you're going to get a look at, I think, the future of the Silvertips. You'll see a really strong Ryan Hofer. He will be probably the anchor, the veteran up front as the O2. Ryan Hofer is a lot of fun to watch just to see him play bully ball when he tries to make his way into the offensive zone. He's thrown some board-rattling hits. He scored some highlight reel goals, so he'll be a lot of fun. But other than that, you're going to see a lot of kids. I think you're going to see a lot of Taryn Smith, who's an 06 defenseman who was a first-round pick last December. I am unsure whether or not they'll dress, but, you know, Carter Bear just got called up, and Carter Bear was a standout in preseason. Julian Mays, who was this past May or June, whenever the 2022 WHL draft was, he was the first-round pick this past summer, and Mays was a point-per-game player as a 14-year-old in the preseason and now has, I think, 18 points in 13 games at the U18 level, again, as a December birthday in 07. So if those guys are all in the lineup, you'll get to see some really exciting young prospects where I think when you go to the game this Friday in Portland, you'll see the Silvertips that you'll be watching for the next 3-4 years.
Yeah, I guess I didn't realize how much they were struggling with injuries, and you know, teams really, you know, generally don't like to call up anybody this time of year. You're disturbing, you know, their schooling and you know the level they're playing at, and you know, it's a different animal, World Junior time or whatever. But you know, they must kind of really be against it to have to go to some call ups.
Yeah, that's the way it is, right? You know, it's you do what you gotta to try to keep competitive, and fortunately I think that there's a very mature base of young players to rely on. I think the coaching staff does a great job of cultivating these players at a young age where they can be depended on. You know, they treat them like they are expected to succeed, and I think that the players feed off that. They want to be able to meet those expectations. They want to be able to thrive and help the organization. So I think they'll be very excited to play this weekend. I think that, you know, it will be very interesting to see how they hang in against Portland and Seattle, especially given what a powerhouse they are. I think this will be a test of metal for a lot of the depth guys on the Silvertips.
Well, and especially, you know, on the back end, if some of these call-ups might have to stick around a little bit with in all likelihood of Olen Zellweger playing for Team Canada come Boxing Day. I mean, what's it been like seeing his progression?
Olen is a game changer. He really is. He's got to be one of the most electrifying players in the Western Hockey League, maybe the Canadian Hockey League. There's a reason he's the reigning WHL Defenseman of the Year, and you know what? He's only getting better. I think that this year, even more so than last year, he's taken charge of possession to where it flows through him. It's really funny. There was a play on Sunday night where they're playing, and the puck bounces out to the center of the blue line in the high slot, and Cam Seitzma, who's a rookie, has the puck. And the crowd starts to rise to their feet because he starts squaring to the net and he starts winding up like he's going to shoot. And the crowd starts to like get that anticipatory ooh going. But from the far side point, even I could hear it up in the booth. You hear Olen Zellweger tapping a stick. And when Olen taps his stick, you got to feed him the puck because that is the respect that he's earned. Because when he calls for the puck, he believes that he can make something happen, and chances are he does. So sure enough, Seitzma looks off the shot, passes it to Zellweger. Zellweger gets it down low and steel queering caps off a rebound and they score. So I think it goes to show how much he's grown as a leader, how much he's grown as a driver of offense, he showed a lot of flashes of brilliance, not just in the AHL Calder Cup playoffs in his debut last year with San Diego, but in the NHL preseason this year with Anaheim. I think that he's brilliant with the puck. He's the second highest shots on goal man in the Western Hockey League behind only Bedard. And to do that as a defenseman is pretty unheard of.
You guys have a dude named Steel? That's pretty fun.
Steel Queering, yeah. He was acquired by a trade from Calgary. Really, really nice kid, but what a hockey name, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's one thing, you know, you'll find the longer you're in this league that there's a lot of names. There's a lot of really interesting names come through here.
Yeah, one of my favorites is on Prince George, they have Bauer Demansky. I always think it's really funny that there's a hockey player who's named after a brand of stick. It's like having a baseball player named Mizuno or Louisville Slugger. Like, it's just, it really is something.
If memory serves, there was a guy on the Wheat Kings named Easton Stick here not really that long ago.
Hey, the Wheat Kings had Wheaton King not too long ago, so you don't got to look very far.
I was fortunate enough to see him play. Not very often the Wheaties come through, but during the Wheaton King era, I was lucky enough to watch him suit up for a proud franchise. So that was fun.
Yeah, that's my favorite name to team relation ever. I forget what team he's on, but there's a kid out in the OHL whose name is T-Bone. I think he's on Saginaw. That's another incredible hockey name. Love that.
So, you know, we talked about the Silvertips, you know, having a strong record, even if, you know, it's kind of a little under the radar, which, you know, sometimes that's a good thing, you know, to be a little, you know, kind of just working in relative anonymity, but, you know, still playing well. And obviously, you know, Portland's playing pretty well, but, you know, you mentioned already, you know, Seattle, you know, acquiring, you know, yet again another high-end defenseman today. I mean, they are making their intentions clear with their poker chips. I mean, what's kind of your read on this year's Thunderbirds?
Seattle is really high octane. And what's funny is that I don't think the one taste that the Silvertips have had in the regular season against the Seattle Thunderbirds was on Everett's Pink the Rink night, and Seattle wins 11-3. And you look at that, you look at the score sheet, you look at the rapid-fire succession that Seattle is able to score, and you think, wow, the Silvertips must have gotten eviscerated that game. They must have looked dreadful. To be honest, I really don't think the Silvertips looked that bad. And I think if you were to do a deeper dive as to, you know, the Silvertips got 49 shots, I'm pretty sure, in that game. And a lot of them were really good ones. I think that it's just a matter of the defense was a little uncharacteristically porous. And I think that Braden Holt and Tim Metzger would be the first ones to admit that they definitely should have had, like, a lot of them. I think that they got beaten clean on shots that don't ordinarily beat them clean. So when you have a bad night for both goalies, it's very hard to overcome that. So I think that, and that's not putting either one of them down. I mean, it's a bad night is a bad night. You give 11 goals. That's just calling a spade a spade. But to speak on how Seattle is built and what they're able to construct, they're incredibly deep. They roll their lines pretty evenly. They're really, really, really fast, which is, I think, a departure from last year's core. Last year, they were a lot more, you know, rock the body, you know, Matt Rempe, Tyrell Bauer, kind of Lucas Siona, Reed Schaefer, all getting in your grill and mucking it up down low. This year, they still have Siona and Schaefer, but now they have Krankovic leading the way. Now they have Grayson Sochin. Now you have, you know, Korchinski taking on an even bigger role than he had last year. So they're an incredibly mobile offense. They're very crisp with the way they exit. They're a well-oiled machine. So adding someone like Nolan Allen is really going to help tighten up that back end. They now have two bona fide shutdown pairs back there. They're just a really good team. And, you know, it's anytime they come in to any given barn, they probably expect to win. So that's just the way that they're built.
Here in the, what, the last 2 weeks has it been since the Pro Cop trade? They've moved out three first rounders, one second, three third rounders, and a sixth amongst others. I mean, and a couple of roster players. I mean, it's gambling debts always get paid. I mean, it better work for them, because there's going to be some pain here, for several years after this.
Yeah, I mean, well, the good news is that, knock on wood, at the very least, they'll be able to make that competition, right? I'm sure a lot of Silvertip fans give the trading of draft picks a bit of a side eye, because the Silvertips had no first round picks from 2017 till 2021, because they were prepping for playoffs that wound up never happening in 2020 and 2021. Those are two teams that probably would have been built for the WHL final, but it's, the world decided it was not to be. So I think that, knock on wood, they'll at least be able to see it through and go for it this year. And honestly, like, if they stay healthy and they compete the way that they are supposed to compete, I mean, you can't really blame them. I'm very curious to see what the response is going to be from Portland and from Kamloops, because I think they are the two most direct threats to Seattle as far as winning the WHL final. Kamloops already has their Memorial Cup berth, and I already said, like, I expect them to be buyers to try to give Stankoven something to work with up front, maybe give them some goaltending support so they have someone to back up Ernst, maybe a mobile blue liner like they had last year in Victor Persson. But I'm very, very curious to see what the response is, since Seattle has been so active so soon in the season. They want everything solidified real quick.
Yeah, and you mentioned the lack of high draft picks for the Silvertips, because they turn those guys into ready-made players for playoffs, and that's a little bit before your time in this league, but Portland was real good at that one for a while. They traded a first rounder for Marcel Nobles. That was to Seattle, which turned into Keegan Colasar, and they had success with him. But I mean, so you can find other ways to do it for sure. But, and you bring up Kamloops, I mean, that's kind of the sleeping giant around here too. That they're gonna add, and I wonder this market, it seems seems pretty steep for the price to add right now. Is certainly what it looks like.
Yeah, the musing that I think a lot of fans I saw speculating, they would kind of, either whether or not it was serious or not, I saw people on Twitter being like, man, what would it take to move a Connor Bedard? Let's say Regina goes like 0-10 out the gate and they want to ship him out. I think this market is determining that it's just not possible. It's just, if you're giving up two firsts, a second, a third, and three good players for Nolan Allen, who's a very good defenseman, probably not a huge point getter, but a really good defenseman, and you're trying to trade for a really high end forward now, let's change the name. Let's make it not Connor Bedard. Let's say I don't even know. Let's say you want to trade for someone on Moose Jaw, right? Let's say you want to add Jagger Furkus, who's an A-list player, but not Connor Bedard. You're still going to give up like four first round picks for a good player like that. It really is wild how high the market is set. So you're going to find out by deadline day who thinks that they can make a push that badly. So I think that if Portland keeps on winning, I would not be surprised if they dip their toe in the water and try to add a big name.
Yeah, I mean, they have done that in the past, that's for sure.
Yeah, they did it last year with Gauthier. I mean, swinging a trade like that to get a bona fide rock back there, that was a really good deal for them last year. So I wouldn't be surprised if they make another move for a rental, because, correct me if I'm wrong, I think they only have two overagers.
They do. They have an overage spot, and it's funny you mentioned Moose Jaw, I was looking, you know, I think it was them that got a really nice player return from the minors, and so then they had a have to move an overager, and I was like kind of looking, and I was like, I'm not sure. I mean, you know, you are what your record says. I'm not sure that Portland really has anything. Their shopping list doesn't seem very long right now, as far as like we could use this, we could use that, but. You know, you can always add, you know, a goal scorer or a fancy defenseman, that's for sure.
Yeah, that's a good position to be in. You know, Portland is so balanced. A lot of their best players are 03s or 04s. Stefan is still only an 03. I really like Marek Alscher. He's an 04. Cagnoni is still only an 04. And he's still so young. He hasn't even hit his 18th birthday yet, and he's so talented. So I think they're in a really interesting spot where if they want to make a push, they can add one more guy, and who knows, an 0-2 probably won't be as expensive. I remember Seattle adding Svechkovsky last year at the deadline, Portland adding Gauthier. Like it's a very good position to be in where you don't necessarily have to, but if you want to, the option is definitely there.
Yeah, and with Seattle and. Again, the way they're playing poker, I mean, you know, it's always a unique situation when your league is hosting. And so if you're Winnipeg, if you're Red Deer, you know, Saskatoon, I mean, in theory, you don't know this, how it's going to play out, obviously, nobody does, but, you know, if Kamloops is good and they make the final, then, you know, an Eastern team can get in without having to only having to win three rounds, you know, and getting the back door that way. Not that anybody's trying to, but you know, it kind of sweetens the pot as far as, you know, making a big push. But again, you know, if you're Seattle, you know, Everett or you know, any of these teams out west, I mean, you don't have that luxury. You still have to go through the host most likely to get to the final. So it's kind of it just really shows how committed Seattle is to try to cause a ruckus this year.
Yeah, they're going for it all. They sense the fact that there's a very winnable, for as tough as the conference is, it's still very winnable, and they have all the right pieces in place. They have a good coach. They're built to win. So they'll be a fun team to watch. And I think that last year's postseason proved that they're difficult to kill too. I mean, they're not just good, they're relentlessly good. Portland was the same way last year, I remember, in all of the matchups with the Silvertips. How many times did we see the Portland Winterhawks stage a third period comeback against Everett last year? It felt like every single game. It didn't matter how big the lead was. 2 goals, 3 goals, Portland would start chipping away and come back. And Seattle did the same thing come playoff time, where they'd be down 3-1 in the series, win game 5, win game 6, win game 7. So they're a resilient group, which I think is even more important than just being good. We've seen that so many times in the hockey playoffs.
You know, we mentioned how, you know, this Silvertips team was poised to to try to do some damage in the year that, you know, we had the chair kicked out from under us, didn't have playoffs, and then bubble season they went like 20-2 or something, right?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, I don't know the exact record off the top of my head, but they were best record in the league. I want to say they were like 19-3, 19-4, something like that. It was the best record in the Western Conference.
Yeah, and you know, folks ask me, you know, about how, you know, what I think of Everett and you know what they're, you know, I mean the cycle that, you know, these teams in major junior go on, as far as, you know, going on a run and then a rebuild, and it just seems like, you know, I keep thinking that eventually the clock's going to strike midnight for the Silvertips team, but this does not appear to be the season that happens, as far as, you know, having continued success. I mean, what are some of the factors that you see, you know, day to day, that you know, contribute to you know, Everett not really surfing that wave, but just kind of staying on top of it?
I think that just there's no recognition that there's any reason to not have faith that they won't be a top four team. I think as long as they feel that they can be in the top four, top three even, come the end of the season, they feel that they can make it to the second, third round. I think that that's a motivation for this ownership group, for this coaching staff, and for a lot of these players. You know, think about someone like Jackson Berezowski, who's been with the Silvertips since 2018, who's been there for the really great teams and the teams that went unfulfilled. So I think someone like him is just so motivated to reach not only the postseason but the later rounds that this group feels that they need to see it through. They have enough players left over where they want to give it one more kick at the can. But I say one more knowing that next year they're probably going to be pushing for the playoffs as well. They're probably going to build around Roost and Hammerling and make a run for it next year. You know, there is no acceptance of a lack of playoffs. It's an edict that is taken on, not like an official ruling, but like every year, why wouldn't you want to win, right? I mean, and I think that this team has the right components. It's got the right leaders. It's got the right coaches to where, you know, are they on paper better than Seattle? Most people would probably tell you no. But in the playoffs, anything can happen. You know, it's the Silvertips don't need to go back very far to prove that happened. They were a one seed that lost to an eight seed last year. Anything can happen in the playoffs.
Yeah, yeah, that was really interesting to see. I mean, there's not upsets are somewhat rare in our league. I mean, that's kind of why they're upsets, I suppose. But that one was pretty shocking. But you know, we saw, you know, when we had that wild card format, and you know, Tri-City made the won the BC division, which they don't even participate in. That was a wild ride, but. But yeah, exactly. If you get in the tournament, you know, and just and see what happens, you know, and you know, game by game, and all those kind of cliches. But you know, I mean, what's it been like, you know, working with Dennis Williams, and what's his kind of what kind of atmosphere does he maintain there at the rink?
He's incredibly driven. He's an incredibly busy guy. He always shows up expecting the best out of his group, and he usually gets it. He extracts every last drop of energy on a nightly basis. I think that something that this organization always prides itself on is win or lose, they always get a very good effort. And I think that's been the case for every single game that I've watched, that I've worked. So there's an expectation of strong effort within this group, and I think that this is a great job done by not only Dennis Williams, but also his associate coach this year, David Struch. Last year it was Louis Mass, who has since joined the San Jose Barracuda. Dean DeSilva, who's the assistant coach. I think they all kind of divide and conquer really well. They tackle different issues in the locker room and different tasks on hand, and they do them so well. So there's good balance, there's good leadership, and I think that there's just a certain code that they live by, which I think is incredibly admirable. And obviously Hockey Canada sees something in Dennis as well, because he'll be their head coach come World Junior time. So, you know, I'm really excited for him and really happy for him that he gets that opportunity, because I know that the experience last year winning gold as an assistant meant the world to him. So I'm excited for him to get that chance.
Yeah, I mean, you'll likely never have that, you know, opportunity, or not never, but I'm saying, you know, the opportunity to have, you know, those kind of horses, you know, all in one, you know, shot. I mean, that's pretty special to be able to have the opportunity to coach the best junior age players in Canada like that.
Yeah, that's and it's every time you, I mean, they always say it, every time that you can represent your country in any capacity is something special, but to be handed the reins as the head coach is such a unique distinction. And it's funny that he's the third Silvertip head coach to coach at the World Juniors to be a head coach. Kevin Constantine ran the USA team back in the early 90s, and then Craig Hartsburg had Hockey Canada for two tournaments in the mid-2000s. So it's a legacy that we're very proud of, that not just players get developed here, but coaches. you know, and for him to come back just a couple of months after just winning gold and do it all again, that's a very exciting prospect.
Well, those mid-90s American teams, they probably needed to trap in order to try to compete in those tournaments. But
that's probably true. Yeah.
Whereas you know, there's the Americans have made, you know, huge strides here in the last, you know, 15 years or whatever in this tournament, and it's you know, they're kind of, you know, with the, up there with the big boys now every year, and you know, win gold, you know, somewhat consistently over the last, you know, 10 years or so.
Yeah, that's true. They've really grown. So it'll be a really fun tournament. You know, last year was really competitive. It literally came down to a matter of centimeters, right? You know, it's Mason McTavish pulling the puck off the goal line that winds up being the difference for Hockey Canada between gold and silver. So the World Juniors is always a really exciting tournament. I know we're all looking forward to watching it.
Well, and you have, you know, Bertrand, you know, making a, you know, glove save on the bench, keeping the puck from going over the glass at one time, looked like a, you know, looked like an outfielder stealing the home run. You got the one that went off the TSN camera against the Russians, and they didn't like that. I mean, it's you know, even with Canada's success, it's been kind of razor thin margins, which, you know, is kind of how it should be, right?
Yeah, that's parity. That's hockey. That's the beauty of it.
You know, and then, you know, normally you're in it against it pretty tough as a club team, having, you know, your head coach and general manager, you know, away for a month for a tournament. But, you know, here comes Dave Struch, and I think people forget that he's on the Silvertips club. And I know, you know, guests of this show that have been around the league for a long time, they can't say enough about the guy. I mean, you know, there's a pretty good, you know, Struch fan club around these parts. I mean, what's it been like having him up there in Silvertip country?
You know, he's just a very classic hockey coach. He's very old school in the way that he carries himself. He's a gentleman in the truest regard. And, you know, he's just very roll up your sleeves, let's get to work kind of guy. Very passionate about the job. And I know that someone of his resume in the offseason to come to Everett, that's a huge get. And I know that Dennis Williams was extremely excited to be able to add him to the staff in the offseason, because of not just his years spent in the league, but his trips to the Memorial Cup, both as a player and as a coach in his time. You know, he was a player when Saskatoon made it in the 90s. He was coached there for Saskatoon when they hosted, for Regina when they hosted. He's seen just about everything in the Western Hockey League. So to have that experience, to provide some different insight for someone who's been around the game as long as he has and around the league as long as he has, it's a really, really great get for this organization, and we're very lucky to work with Strucci.
Well, that 2013 Saskatoon team, that was the only team to beat Halifax and Nathan MacKinnon that whole tournament. So they there's not a lot of moral victories in that tournament, but they certainly could feel pretty good about that.
Yeah, that's true. So he's seen a lot of talent come through the league, and he knows what it takes to win, and he's able to impart that knowledge onto our group. So he's a very, very knowledgeable individual.
So I kept you for a little while, Casey. I mean, there are some other points about this Silvertips team or the rest of the league that you want to touch on while we're chatting.
I don't know. Yeah, it's your ship. I'm just along for the ride. You know, I think that it's an exciting time at this point. Now we're getting really into the nitty gritty. You know, the honeymoon stage is worn off on a season, and now you really get to see what your team is made of. You start to really get to push into the dog days of December and January, where, you know, you're trying to grind it out until that holiday break around Christmas time, and then you're off in the second half. So it's just an exciting time. I'm just happy to be along for the ride, Chad.
and then again, in your position, you got to check your phone every couple of minutes to see if anybody got, you know, added to the team, or some picks moved out, or, I mean, breaking news in the middle of the night. That's always a fun ride for the communications guy, right?
Yeah, exactly. You're always you're always trying to keep an ear to the ground, and you're just trying to stay afloat with all the news. You know, that's what's funny is that you wake up every morning and it seems like there's another trade that Seattle's pulled. So, but by the time this gets posted, they probably have pulled another one.
That or the, you know, friends of the show, the Edmonton Oil Kings, and they just they posted just a scoring update to their game the other day, and I saw like just kind of the way the arrows were drawn in there. I thought you guys traded somebody again.
yeah, they don't have a ton left from their WHL final team, so yeah.
Yeah,
they're probably still continuing the fire sale. Who knows?
Yeah. Well, you know, when I had Kurt Hill on, you know, earlier this season, I asked him about it. I mean, it's kind of, you know, you have that challenge. It's like you know, sometimes when you invade a country militarily, and we're gonna depose the guy. Okay, now what? You know, I mean, like you went through the thing you were trying to do, and you took the flag. And now you got to start over. So you mean, you know, do you have is that part of the folder blank? I mean, you know, what do you do with it? So it's kind of a, you know, it's a tricky, you know, position to be in. But you know, again, one that you're hoping to get to that point, because that means, you know, you won the whole thing, and they did. So
yeah. I mean, hey, you can't sneeze at a ring, right? Rings a ring, and banners hang forever.
Yeah, and you won all those trades at that point. You know, I mean, the 2018 Swift Current Broncos will tell you that, and the 2019 PA Raiders. Although they got no one took it from them for 2 years after that, so they had the bonus on that. So
yeah, so they got some good mileage out of it.
Well, Casey, it's nice having you on the show to catch up. It's fun having you in the league. It's nice to see your enthusiasm and what you bring to the table. And I suspect that the Silvertip Country is happy to have you.
Well, I certainly hope so, because I'm happy to be in it. So it's been a lot of fun, and I'm looking forward to the rest of the campaign. Can't thank you enough for having me on here, Chad. I really appreciate it.
You're doing me the favor there, Casey. I appreciate it. So, all right. Thanks, man.
All righty. Thank you. Take care, Chad. All right.